film. And I just want to congratulate you. You're one person who has kind of consistently worked for the documentary movement for so many years and made the medium visible to many people and so many festivals, so many screenings. So let me congratulate you and thank you for this initiative and having us with you.
Thank you, sir.
It
Thank
is
you, sir.
really commendable work that you do.
And
Thank you, sir.
we had the good fortune of screening your films many times at
Artist.
AISS when we were there. And we've also been happy to come to Madurai and
Yeah.
participate in your festival.
Yeah.
So, I mean, in person, but of course,
Yes,
many,
yes. Yes, sir.
not only our films, but also our
We
students.
have had two retrospectives, no? One in Madurai, one in Chennai of
Yes.
his.
That's right.
Such a wonderful experience.
Yes. I also had a personally wonderful houseful film screenings at TIS, when I showed my Kodungallam film at the department.
Yeah.
Really houseful. People
It
are
was so
sitting in
houseful
front of
that
the
people were like
sitting
6 inches away from the screen.
screen. Yeah. Okay.
Okay,
Okay, nice. Yeah. Just please,
so
yes.
to come back to our films, we actually came upon this work that was happening in Kutch almost by accident sometime in 2008, when we heard the music and saw some of the pictures. A friend of ours was doing some community radio work at that time, and he happened to share that material with us, and we were very fascinated by the music, by the space, and we thought, let's just pay a visit. So in early 2008 we went for the first time, and I think that was the beginning of our love affair with Kutch and with all the formerly nomadic communities that lived there. So our first film we made around that time, but it was not just about making films, but about spending time with people in that area, listening to their stories, interacting with them. And there was a whole lot of other material that we were collecting along the way. We didn't have a clear idea as to what film would come out of that. So it's almost as if the film emerged, from our long-term engagement with communities there. This is the second film, as some of you might know. The first film is called Do Din Ka Mela. This one is Sohela Sohoda, and each of them is working with different communities in the area. And the third one is A Delicate Weave, which is the most recent one, which was completed in 2017. So it's been a kind of ongoing relationship with the space over a period of over 10 years, and it's a kind of journey through which we've learned a lot from the communities that we've interacted with, and we really value that knowledge.
So as Anjali said, we worked for so many years, about 9 years, and we were, as when we started working, we didn't realize what was the outcome. And of course, three films have been made, and we have enough material to probably make a couple more. Let's get back to it after a while. So one of the things that kind of really impressed us was the fact that, when there was widespread ethnic violence in Gujarat during after post-Godhra episode, there was almost no ethnic violence in Kutch. So that's one reason why we thought we were really surprised that, though it's part of this Gujarat, it kind of witnessed very little violence. And we found that communities, which is, it's a multi-ethnic society, but the communities kind of live relatively harmoniously there, which is why we decided to kind of explore this idea more. And so that's where we kind of found these strong traditions of Sufi and syncretic music, as well as religious kind of practices. So which is why we decided to kind of continue to work there. So it was a long association, and we learned so much from the local communities and their wisdoms in the process.
So this specific film, as I presume that you would have seen it, most of you, is about three cousins. And they're from a community called Patirani Jats, which were earlier nomadic and mainly camel herders. And they kind of, one of them sings and he actually works in a dairy. The other one is a truck driver and plays a very rare instrument called the surando, and it's the only surviving surando in the whole of Kutch. And the third person, who's an older person called Haji Umar, he kind of walked into our film. We started off with these other two cousins, and Haji Umar happened to be visiting one of them, and then we were so fascinated by his stories and the way he had sort of internalized the writings of Shah Abdul Latif Bhutai, because the film is around the way in which the Fakirani Jat community relates to the work of Shah Abdul Latif Bhutai. So for us to, this was the first time we encountered this marvelous Sufi mystic who lived. We encountered this Sufi mystic who lived many centuries ago, but whose work still inspires people, rings out to people across so many generations.
Yeah. Yeah. Whoever watches your film would always be impressed and surprised by your particular way of making. And it will be interesting if you can explain the kind of filmmaking style that you have developed over the period of 30 years. You know, like what kind of a filmmaking you were actually started, what kind of filmmaking you're perceiving, the style, the way you use your images, the way you use interview silence, and the way the idea of choosing such topics. What was actually driving you as filmmakers? You know, like if you can explain to us.
Yeah. First of all, both of us are not trained filmmakers. We kind of strayed into filmmaking. So we call ourselves self-learning filmmakers, because I guess we are still learning and trying to learn. I think there's certain kind of ideological concerns that impel our work. I mean, it's not that it was sort of programmatic, but if we look at our work over a period of time, both ideological as well as in terms of the method we use. Maybe I'll talk about the method and Jayashankar can talk about the concerns. So one thing is that we believe that, the kind of relationship that a filmmaker has with others who are very different from them is of course fraught with all kinds of issues and problems and what one can call the ethics and politics of representation. How do we, from a very different world, engage with others, try to, and I mean, can we ever speak on their behalf? I mean, there's been a lot of critique of people from outside speaking on behalf of subaltern groups, and that critique is very well founded. So I think we it sort of came about maybe just through our concerns, and not that I don't know how much we thought about it, but we sort of decided to work in as collaborative way as possible with our subjects, and this has been something that we have been doing for many years, right, from our early work. So that's one thing. Working collaboratively means sharing one's project with them, involving them in conceiving and shaping the project, and then sharing whatever we do back with them and taking their view on it before it goes anywhere else. So that's something that we've practiced all through, right from our early films, right from Kahankar Ahankar in 95 to even our present work.
So we, this film and even on the other, three films kind of, or most of our work kind of, also is an attempt to kind of problematize this position of the filmmaker. Invariably, we are people who kind of paratroop into other people's lives and take away the images. And you know, there is an unequal exchange that takes place between us and them, so to speak. So we always want to problematize such a thing. So you will find in most of our work, there may not be similar, but devices which kind of question this relationship or foreground this relationship and the kind of problematic that is associated with that relationship. So here you would find a lot of times when the subjects are kind of talking back to us, and talking back to us also means talking back to the audience, and thereby kind of foregrounding the idea that, you know, there is an act of representation. The act of representation is not just a seamless activity of bringing images of them to the audience, but it's also a very complex negotiation that takes place between us and the subjects, and therefore the subjects and the audiences. So the audience can also get a sense of what transpires between the act of filming. That's one idea. As I said earlier, all the three films were impelled by this idea that though it is located in Gujarat, they kind of presented to us at least not that Modi's Gujarat, but another kind of Gujarat, which is we were fascinated. And we realized how Sufism as a philosophical tradition, which is, I mean, it's not an elite tradition, it's kind of, in this film, Haji, for example, he's not lettered, as we know, he has not gone to university or studied, but, you know, displays tremendous wisdom in terms of looking at the world, in terms of looking at relationships between community, in terms of looking at life itself. So we thought that is something that we want to kind of foreground and learn from. So it's not that kind of, I'm not saying that everybody does it, but you know, what we wanted to do was not to make a film about them or kind of learn more about them, but to learn from them as, so to speak.
And in the process, learn about us too.
Yes.
Because their gaze on us is as important as our gaze on them, and right. That negotiation of
contribution. And this was kind of, this film was, the second film was made in collaboration with the PSPT, but otherwise, the other two were made as part of our work with Tata Institute of Social Sciences. And Amudan asked us this question about filmmaking styles. So he, I mean, as part of the same session, we all know that he worked with low budgets. You yourself, Amudan, know this. And you know, we are kind of forced to kind of work with very small budgets and therefore multitask. We do everything like you do. I do the camera and we do the editing together. We mix the sound together. So,
except for the sound recorders.
Except for the sound recorders. We have a wonderful sound recorder who did the sound for us. So we have learned to work with perforce because of the kind of constraint that we have faced. That's where we said we're still learning.
Yeah, and I think one more concern which sort of has been there through our work is the whole idea of people's knowledge, people's wisdom, right from our early work with the Warlis in Maharashtra to our work with prisoners who write poetry to so many other films. We've had a kind of fascination with trying to understand and learn from people's wisdom that comes from their experiences, that comes from that is not normally regarded as valid knowledge. And we feel that the kind of knowledge that people like us who come from universities keep reproducing is highly overrated, and one needs to learn also from very much so. It's a humbling experience to learn from people who come from a very different position from oneself and to learn what they have to teach us. So that's why it also critiques the safe space that we come from.
Okay. So before I start asking my other questions, I will start inviting others. So thank you, Dr. Anjali Jayashankar. So I will go to Mr. Vijayan. who is always our inaugurator in questions, who will inaugurate the process of reflection. So let me invite Mr. Vijayan to start his sharing. Mr. Vijayan. Mr. Vijayan?
You're muted.
He has to. Vijayan, you're there?
Yeah, very much.
Hello. Yes. Yes, sir. Come on. Yeah. Go ahead.
So let me begin by congratulating the two paratroopers, so to say, because the key thing which I could notice is that they were feeling so much comfortable in front of the facing the camera, because I think they probably knew the motive that it is to record their life, and the sincerity within you, your approach to them. So you could make them absolutely comfortable. And that's one key thing which struck me. And as personally, for me, it was an entirely different milieu which came to my knowledge. And it was a really, besides the visual beauty of it, the richness of their life, the sincerity, the strength of the Rusalo poems and Bidai's this thing. It's absolutely marvelous.
Thank you so much.
And see their pastoral life, they lead a life of very meager existence. Their needs are limited. And how do they meet their day-to-day expenses for day-to-day life? Is it by selling camel's milk or something? Or how do they make and find the means of living? That is one observation. And as regards the richness of the poems, somewhere there's a mention that one stanza has got 360 meanings.
Yeah, some technical.
Just see the depth of the poem being recreated by somebody. I think the material should be available. Has any attempts been made to recreate the thing? Because you have mentioned that there are only two left, one with Haji and the other one with that guy. Mm-hmm. So I think somebody should take initiative of trying to not to lose them, because once it is lost, it's gone. Mm-hmm. And so let me congratulate you, Dr. Jayashankar, and Anjali for the wonderful treat. And in fact, I hope your other the trilogy, you'd like to see the other two movies or documentary also. Yeah. Is it available in your website or anywhere?
Oh. Available online.
Yeah, congrats once again. Thank you. Okay.
Most of them, they were traditionally cattle herders, but many of them, as the second truck driver says, it's really very difficult to make a living through cattle herding these days, when it's a kind of the grazing lands are not there. A lot of the areas that were formerly used for grazing have been parceled out and given to cement factories, and there is a kind of ecological degradation that has taken place. So, they do try to make a living from cattle herding, but some of them also have agriculture. Some of them have fishing there. This particular part of Kutch is very close to the coast, so they also survive from fishing. But certainly, they cannot survive from singing or playing the instrument, because there isn't a quote-unquote market enough for that. So this is something they do. Their musical and storytelling traditions is something they do in addition to whatever else they do for managing their livelihood. And a lot of the time they sing within their own community for at weddings and other functions. And it was only after the Kutch Mahila Vikas Sangathan kind of started this community radio platform that many of them got an exposure outside and managed to kind of get an audience beyond their own communities. And as Haji mentions, this audience, I mean the audience within the community is also kind of under threat, because as other forms of music, as more popular forms of media become available, then people, the younger people, are not really interested any longer in these traditional forms. Of course, there are attempts to revive many of these forms, which is the subject of our third film. It's another story.
Yeah, but, and I'm really glad that you bring up the story about those 360 different interpretations. In fact, if you ask us the key to the film, there are two stories which fascinate us. And they have been significant in terms of how what the film is planning, is hoping to do. Is that, for example, all pre-modern society, many other, they have always had a respect to the idea of one structure having many meanings. One text having several different ways. Say, take Kabir, for example. There's not one single Kabir. There are thousands and thousands of Kabir. The oral tradition, they kind of grow. It's not that it is fixed, the meaning is fixed. Nobody can say that, look, this is Kabir. The Kabir is kind of something that you discover for yourself. It's a dynamic process of interpretation. You listen to Kabir, and there are ways of seeing him, ways of listening to him, ways of understanding. So which is not just a interpretative practice or aesthetic, but it's a matter of deep philosophical significance. Most of our violence that we see today is the insistence that this text only means this. This identity only means I am a Hindu, or I am so and so, and therefore, and this is what it's all about. Hardening of identities as well as systems of meaning. Whereas this idea of one text could mean 360 different ways that you can look at it. So it's an even identities, or the idea of meaning itself is something that kind of evolves. And therefore, the violence that most, for example, science or other hegemonic knowledge systems kind of always tell you this means this. And there's no, and I am the authority who's telling you this. But here is a mode in which you can find 360 or 3,600 or 36,000 meaning possibilities, depending on your own concerns and the way you look at it. That's a key story that it is. And that is a key story, which is why Sufism is so significant in terms of critiquing this whole hardening of identity politics, as well as this kind of authorities who kind of say that this is what it means, this text, be it a Veda, be it whatever religious text or scripture. So this is what it is all about, and you need to take it from me. But here is a mode in which they can question, and there are ways in which various meanings can emerge depending on your concept. So that's an important key to the film, that which we think is significant. The other interesting story about their relationship with these texts, the story about Haji tells that he wanted to learn these texts, and he didn't want to kind of learn Sindhi or anything. So he went to an elderly person in the village, and he has learned it from, you remember that story, I don't know. He says that his mother was very happy with him, and the mother asked him, and he always wanted to learn the risalas of the text of Shabdala Tipitai. So the mother asked him, what do you want? I'm very pleased with you, ask for anything. The story there. And if you ask me what I want, my mother asked me, I can think of thousands of things that I asked, could be a Ferrari, or it could be riches, or it could be anything that I can think of. But he asked that I only want to learn this text by heart without actually doing it. So you see the kind of commitment to these things. It's not just a text, and these very simple village communities only think as ignorant, illiterate, and without knowledge, and we people, particularly people like us who inhabit universe, we think that we all, everything that is to be known, and we But this is a moment where that kind of commitment to a text, to learn that text, is the most important thing for them. And what does that text teach you? The text teaches you that there are 360 ways of looking at each stanza of that text. Which is, I mean, these two stories actually are the key to that film. If you are, I mean, that's what we think they hold. And, you know, and it's kind of, as Haji himself says, that like Shahabdulatif Bhittai has, you know, several metaphors that he uses to talk about these multitudes of meanings and beings of life. There, those stories, I think, are significant for us. I'm sorry, I just took it wrong.
Thank you. So can I, Mr. Vijay, happy? Can I go to the next question? Yes, I'm sorry, happy.
And sorry, I had to leave a bit early because I got at some other meeting at 11:30. So please, apologies to Dr. Jaishankar and Anjali. And thank you, Amud, and look forward to the wonderful movie next week.
Yes.
And bye-bye, friends. Thank you.
Can I invite Mr. Sailendra? He wanted to ask. Mr. Sailendra, can I introduce yourself?
Yes. This is Sailendra. Good morning to everyone, and I would like to congratulate Professor Jaishankar and Anjali Montero for this poetically rich film. The very opening shot, as I was watching it, gave me a thought that it's going to be a poetic. And I would say that you stayed true to the spirit of the film, the ethnic music. And you have not communicated that you were other going over there and making a film, but you were totally part of them.
I was actually wondering, how were you able to get their confidence? And there was a candid conversation among them as they were cooking. The woman speaks to her husband, "Oh, these people have come out and they're shooting what they must be shooting and what they're going." It was quite interesting to watch that conversation of theirs. What was the kind of research that you have done before doing this film? And other than these questions, I would like to appreciate you. Some of the shots were really good, especially the wild shots, the open fields. They really well merged with the epic music of their film and the poems of their. Are you able to hear me?
Yes.
Please go ahead. Please go ahead.
So there's something which I very much liked it. So I'd like to hear from you. How were you able to merge with them as you were making the film?
Yeah, I'll talk about the first question. Jaishankar, who's the camera person, can address the second one. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, we spent a lot of time in the area, not just making this film, but just so we go at least twice or thrice a year. Maybe we didn't have a very large budget, so we couldn't stay for very long, maybe a week at a time. And, you know, sort of met these people, had conversations with them, and documented something, you know, so the film sort of emerged through that process. So we had some material, and the material sort of spoke to us and said, yes, there's a film here. So then we kind of, it was at that stage that we began to conceptualize what this film might be. And in fact, we then made a proposal to PSPG, which got funded. Our initial film, we had just two characters, but the third one came into the film. So it was, what shall I say, not just about the film, but also about understanding the worldview, also about spending time with people, also about them wanting to be a part of the film. But there was one sort of issue, particularly with the Jat communities, which was about you know, the appearance of women in the film. So there was some kind of initial, not even initial, I would say, but there are different groups of Jats. In some of the Jat communities, it's very, very strict. They would not want women to appear at all in the film. And we did visit and try to document in some of those communities, and we found it very difficult, and we abandoned that project. But when we came here, they said, well, let's see, and you talk to our sarpanch, and then we also shared with them the previous film that we made. So the men were on board with us, and they said, yeah, you can go ahead. But with the women, it was a little different, and you can see that in the beginning there was some amount of lack of trust. Though, of course, they knew that we had come through an NGO that they were, knew very well, and they had a long association with. But still, they kind of couldn't place us, or couldn't, were concerned about, and rightly so, about what they're going to do with that material. But as, we made several trips, and one thing which we tried to do is to share the rushes back with them, at least bits of the rushes, And of course, once the film was completed, the rough cut of the film, we shared with them, and we got their feedback on it. So that was the kind of process of, because they also felt that it was important to document these traditions. You know? As the Haji's wife says towards the end of the film, that, I feel good that you have recorded my music. Ultimately, it might have started out as our project, but I think it also, over a period of time working with them, it also became their project.
Yeah, and also as you know, we are making it in 2010-11 when you're shooting this, and maybe in
we can't hear you.
Yeah, sorry. What I was saying is that we've been working there from 2008, and this is being made in 2010-11. So we have had a lot of familiarity with many of these groups, in spite of the fact that there were some reservations about in this particular case, which we kind of were able to kind of overcome. So that's one thing, and many of these traditions are disappearing. So that's also one concern that we. You see the sort of the only two people playing, one person playing it, and there's another musical called double flute called Jodia Pava. Only very few people playing it. Now, there are various traditions which are dying out because of the lack of interest in young people and opportunities for them to perform. And thirdly, of course, also there is a certain kind of hardening of religious divides, which is like beginning to come in. And both religious, the traditional Hindu religion, or even the kind of Islam that is now beginning to become dominant, both look down upon these religions. So they are also disappearing. So that's one reason why we were, but the concern is not just to conserve them, but to learn from them and how we can kind of use this insight to look at ourselves and the world. So about the white shorts and that kind of there throughout the film, there are a couple of ideas that we're working with. One is that if any one of you have been to Kutch, it's a space which is kind of spectacular in many senses. There are very little, many places, if you say went to the run, of Kutch, there's not even a blade of grass that you will see. So you can do a 360-degree pan of your camera and see nothing. So it's kind of that kind of spectacular scale. And so that's one thing that the film kind of tries to better. The second thing about Sufi tradition is what it is talking about. In fact, this landscape renders itself very well for that tradition. The attitude of Sufi, it's kind of talking about the insignificance of human existence in this world. It's talking about the insignificance of what we call human being and its relationship with nature as part of the web of life. So we thought it's interesting to kind of see these figures. For instance, if you looked at the last shot of the film, there is this Haji walks across the horizon, and he's tiny as an ant in this large landscape. So it kind of points to the fact that it tries to kind of appropriate the idea of this insignificant of human beings in the last few things. And also, the other important idea in Sufism as well as many other, say, Buddhism, various traditions is the idea of grief, which, or you know, grief as a fundamental, what should I say?
Horizon.
The horizon of human existence. You know, we think that we are in control of our lives, but you know, the next moment a tragedy might await us. So the whole life is kind of framed in this idea of grief, or as Buddha calls it, dukkham, or you know, in the Sufi tradition, actually Haji is to attend in inviting to this idea of grief.
Sorrow has no hands and
yes. He's talking about the idea. So the idea of tragedy, we think that we're in control, but the next moment we don't know what's going to happen. And it's that kind of points to the finitude and frailty of human existence. But we kind of think of ourselves as all powerful, in control, and things, stuff like that. So that's something we tried appropriating with it. So it also, the idea of unfulfillment. It's that, you know, in the end, in the long run, we are all dead. So, you know, unfulfillment waits all of us at the end of our lives. You know, it's tragedy, grief, unfulfillment. So in fact, the first shot, not only kind of invites one to the various concerns of the film, the relationship between human beings and machines, human beings and nature. And the idea that many of the stories of Bitai kind of talks about this, the idea of unfulfillment, because he constantly talks about these lovers, which he uses as metaphors, which Arjun points to, who cannot meet at the end, be it Omar Marvi. Or there are many, all these stories are there where there is tragedy. The lovers never kind of find fulfillment at the end. So that idea is something that is kind of, you know, those trucks kind of coming in as a humorous kind of take on this whole idea of not being able to, because it's a mirror shot of a truck. And we set it up. I mean, we looked for it for several days before we found that space to kind of shoot that. So the other way in which kind of recurs is the idea, you will find in the film many shots where, as a camera person, and you know, as a camera person, you know, we tend to be, at least I tend to be very impatient, trying to do the camera capture, you know, very predatory, looking at creating this content. But there, I kind of allowed things to happen. So that, for example, a bird that comes into the frame and escapes from the air. So which I did nothing. I mean, a bird might go across, or a bird might just fly by. So it allowed me a certain kind of detachment, at the same time, interest in that image. So that's something that I work with. So you'll see a lot of those images, the things just walk across, move across. There could be a bubble that floats across the water, or a dragonfly that splits in. So, you know, or pelican, or those flamingos that just walk across the horizon. They just do what they want. So, you know, the idea of lack of control is something that, in fact, in the previous one, the first film called Dhotin Ka Mela, there is this opening shot, which is about 3 minutes long. It's actually about four animals that walk across. So, you know, it just, I mean, I didn't know that they would walk across or do whatever. So it kind of allowed to the things to happen. And it's also interesting that, you know, when I did that, it's like almost editing itself in some sense, because I didn't have to intervene at the time of editing. You know, I have to cut it at a certain point, you know, the animal or a thing that started from the one end of the frame and actually organically ended the edit when the, so, I mean, these are some of the, I mean, I'm not saying that these kind of work for everybody, but these are some of the concerns that we work with. So you will find the recurring motive of abandoning control, allowing, setting it up. Of course, we do set it up. We do set up our lives. We set, we want, do not, we have a sense of control, but at the same time, inviting the viewer to the idea of actually that sense of control restriction. We have no control over anything around us, our lives, and we are insignificant. Sorry for the long answer.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anuj wanted to ask something. Anuj?
Yes, I'm here.
Sorry. Please go ahead.
Okay. Yes. So good morning to all. And I'd like to first introduce myself and the two friends that I've brought here. We are all students of Dr. Jaishankar and Anjali ma'am. And we are learning a lot from them in an ongoing process. And two musings I had about the film. First was what sir discussed before as well. Am I audible properly?
Yes, you are.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, sir. Sorry. So one was the very fact that only one couplet of mystic had so many meanings that it immediately took me back to the story of Mirza Ghalib giving away his diwan for that one couplet from the other poet. So that was, yes, it was very interesting. And the way you told us that, you know, you started out with the two cousins, but the third one was actually a storyteller. He just, you know, sort of got in the film. So that, and he has done very well there, right? In the scene where his wife and him, they are sitting and very casually, the both of them prepare meal and they ask you whether you want to have tea or something. And she very, very subtly, she says, do it before the food. Okay. If you want tea, tell me now and we'd have it before the food. So yes, these musings were all very interesting and they pulled me in the story. Second was the story of Marui. Okay. So it reminded me of the story of Sita and Ram. As you know, Marui says, she tells Umar that she doesn't want to live here and she goes back finally. But when back in Mali, her chastity is being put to question. So here, their folk story, it takes a different turn. Here, Umar doesn't allow anybody to lay a finger on, and he wants to, you know, attack the people who question the chastity of that woman. And she in turn pacifies him in this folk story, and she goes through the same fate as Sita, and she proves herself on a pyre of fire. But this sort of made me think how I'm so sorry. So this sort of made me think how our tradition of oral recitation of stories doesn't really allow us to go find a final verdict on some story. You know, there are always n number of permutations for stories, and sort of what our ancestors maybe thought, you know, for us to choose whichever one suits our narrative or our times. So these were my musings, and I'm so thankful that I was, you know, I got to watch this and be a part. Thank you.
Can I add something? You bring up a very important point in the sense that, for example, you know, say take Ramayana or, you know, even this, there's this kind of insistence on one idea. So there's a very interesting article by A.K. Ramanujan called 300 Ramayanas. 300 Ramayanas. There are so many different Ramayanas, which is, so Sita centric, for example. There are many ways in which the Malayalam filmmaker called G. Aravindu made this amazing film called Kanchana Sita, for example. So what I'm trying to say is that these kind of stories, the way that you looked at narratives, they existed all along, but we have lost it somewhere, and we kind of now look at narratives as one thing. We know who Ram is and what Ramayana is all about and where he was born as well, which is a matter of
exactly
significant for our lives. But the question here is that of the idea that these are narratives which are open to interpretation. 316, 3600, the more the merrier, in some sense. The more the interpretation possibility, the more significant that person, which is what Bitta is talking. The other interesting idea is about Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai was born in Kutch, so there was Sindh and Kutch are just divided by this it's a kind of, and in the old days people would, there was no what you call a border there, it's a line on the sand. People would just, when there was a drought in Kutch, people would go to Sindh, and from Sindh people would come to Kutch when they so it was kind of a porous border, which was kind of people just walk across. And what Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai, that's where the title of the film comes from, like here and like there. Talk about here and there, but it's all the same in some sense. And that border is a fictitious line on that sand. So Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai, he kind of decided to wander. So he kind of went from Sindh. He went to Punjab, he went to Rajasthan, and then to Kutch, and then went back to Sindh. And in the process, he learned about Sikhism, and he learned a lot about Advaita Vedanta, and he learned various other marginal traditions that he walked. And and of course, part of the Sufi lore that also, so for example, many of the stories are also part of Rajasthan and Punjab as well. Soni Mehwal. There are various stories that he kind of picks up. That way his work is a truly syncretic. In some sense, kind of takes various traditions. And various parts that he moved. So that's something that you see in this book.
The idea of what one could call a nomadic approach to life. Today, particularly post-independence with modernity, the nomad has been tied down and marginalized. Whereas, of course, one is not glorifying the earlier way of life, and that had its own issues and problems. But the idea of movement was kind of not looked upon with suspicion. It was a part of life. But today, you want to move across a border and, you become a terrorist, a spy, there's no valid movement possible across certain borders. And in a sense, a lot of Bhittai's work questions the idea of, these kinds of borders that divide us, and at the end of the day, he says, here or there, this or that,
friend or enemy,
God and Satan, it's all the same. So, we thought it was a kind of a remarkable thought that we were touched by.
Okay. Thank you, Anush. Thank you, Dr. Anjali Jayashankar. I go to Jayashanti? Jayashanti.
Especially the shorts, you've talked extensively on that.
Suddenly, your voice is so low. So low.
Okay, one second, sir. Loud enough now?
Yes.
Oh, okay. One second, sir. I think it's because of the internet. So, yes. One scene where these birds are moving, right? It kind of reminded me of Manto's story for some strange reason. They are just moving and in a way it was reminding me of Toba Tek Singh. This was one shot which was interesting, and there were few more where the ordinary becomes the focal point. That is, husband and wife cooking or, two people cleaning. This is not directly talking a lot about the ideological component of men and women coming together or doing things, but it's just there. And if you want to see, you are able to see sort of a narrative that was coming in. Then my questions are on two things. One, How was the subtitle work for you? Because it looks like more of a translation, something that I've seen in the past also when Marupakkam has screened. But here it was even more evident because of the rhythm and the spiritual element that is involved in these songs or even their dialogues, right? How was the subtitle work for you? Then the second question is, as teachers, how do you steal time to make films? Because there is already a work, and then you have teaching, you have research, you have writing. In between, you do these films. How do you, make that happen? Two questions. I'll ask the last question later.
I think Vijayashanti is planning to make films.
So I will talk about it to you. It's somewhere happening. This journey is.
Yeah, I know. I can see. Okay.
Yes. Your answer is one of them.
Answering your second question first. It's certainly a kind of challenge. And earlier films, we were more or less full time filmmakers. But from 2007, we've been teaching. Yeah, we've been teaching at other places, but. Setting up a new program, I mean, the order of involvement is different, and then, making it, kind of developing it, developing new curricula, developing a kind of worldview that, collectively with a group that, we feel committed to. It's taken a lot of energy, but I think somewhere we felt that our filmmaking did speak to our teaching and vice versa. Many of the concerns are similar. Of course, finding time, I think one reason is that we are also partners in real life, so sometimes it's 24 hours, breathing, discussing, kind of you. There's no very clear separation between personal life and work life, so maybe that kind of intensity also made it possible to. Find the time to produce the work. A lot of the time we had to go travel during vacation time, and sometimes that's not the best time of year to shoot, in summer where Kutch is scorchingly hot, temperatures go up to as much as 48 degrees, 49 degrees. So it's been some of the, it is physically grueling, some of the shooting. But I think we've had a lot of fun and I think it's been a great journey.
No, and for us as we are media researchers, teachers, and filmmakers. But if you ask us to pick one activity that's oxygen to us is filmmaking, so that kind of we find it extremely pleasurable, and it kind of challenges us. Every film is a dreadful challenge in each time we feel so anxious about how. Or whether I'm going to be able to do this at all. So that's a significant thing. And I think we worked together for 36 years, or about 35 years. There is very little time that we do have other personal commitment, but then this become part of our personal life as well. So making films, of course, we had to find time around our teaching and other stuff that we do. But that's something that actually impels us, and that kind of we find the most important thing. Because, and also, what is significant about it is that teaching is interesting, research is interesting. But what actually sustains our lives is our ability to learn from communities. So we have kind of worked with one of the major wealth that we have is our ability across the country to have worked with various communities, which has kind of been a humbling and learning experience. From Kutch to, we have done films on set in Tamil Nadu, Kutch, various places in Maharashtra, Gujarat, other parts. So each one of these has been a learning experience. So that's something that is very, I wouldn't trade in for any other activity like teaching and research. So we do find time for that. teaching, of course, happens as part of our funds or work.
Okay. What was your first question?
On subtitling.
Okay.
So there's a very complex negotiation. So we don't speak, I mean, though we have been around for what, 8 or 9 years, we do understand some of the language, I mean, like Kachi or Sindhi. Sindhi is more difficult, Kachi is more understandable, because Gujarati is something that, you know, a little bit. Ultimately, you have to subtitle for be able to speak to others. But that's not the best of experience. I mean, ideally, you would be able to understand all the languages. But this is such a complex, there is also a politics of language that you don't see there, because these communities actually speak a certain kind of Sindhi to each other. And the interviewer we have, the interpreter we have is actually a Kachi speaking person. And we are from various other universities. So, you know, there is a moment at which he's asking, the wife of Haji Umar has to ask the little girl, Hawa, about what verse is that. So he's asking her in Kachi, and she's speaking to her in the little child in Sindhi, and translating Sindhi back to Kachi to him. And he's telling us in Hindi or whatever. You know? So there is a complex negotiation of languages. And also these languages are getting marginalized, because I think all the education is in Gujarati, and they learn how to sing bhajans in schools, which have no significance for their lives, and Gujarati. So, I mean, of course, that's one of the issues that we cannot deal with. I mean, you have to translate them in English. But there's, of course, these translations have been done by a poet.
The poetry part of it.
The others, we have done it with sitting with somebody else, and a little bit of Kachi and Sindhi we do understand as well, because we have worked there for 8-9 years. But, of course, there is the fundamental question, other than the question about subtitle. The question is about writing down these poetry. You remember, there is a very significant story that which we have included. Shah Abdul Latif Bidai, at the end of his life, he said, this is all pointless, all these texts that I've written. He just throws it into a pond. I mean, he's a lake or whatever. He abandons them. And then somebody wants to rewrite it, so they go to a lady who kind of, the only one who knew this bad, and writes it down. But writing also brings certain amount of violence to these texts. You know, oral traditions are open-ended. Oral traditions are kind of open to interpretation. Oral traditions grow. It's not that, you know, when I pass it on from one this tradition to the other, they're like rivers in some sense. You know, a river when flows, what the river is at the origin is not what the river when it meets the sea. The river kind of absorbs all kinds of things. It meets a lot of civilization. The river learns. The river grows, the river becomes different. You know, it's not the same river from beginning to end. So like that, oral traditions are like rivers. In some sense, it kind of has no fixed boundaries. They kind of flow. So it kind of also becomes larger, smaller, wider, more rich, deeper, whatever that is. So anybody, when you write it down, then they kind of a violent act. Then it's a process of authority. And I know what this text means. I know you know this. And your access to the text is through me. But I'll tell you whether you're doing this text correctly or not. In fact, when we showed this film to some Sindhi scholars, oh, they said, no, this is not really Bidai. These guys are, I mean, these people like Haji, who have kind of breathes Bidai. They said, no, this is all incorrect. You know, the actual text is very different. So what I'm saying is that writing down and it fossilizes it. So, but in the case of subtitling, it's a much more pragmatic thing of kind of being able to speak to a large audience.
And Haji also helped us with many of the translations.
Mm-hmm. I would call up.
So we would call up on the phone and you know, play the thing to him, and then he would tell us in Hindi, because he knew Hindi very well. I mean, Urdu, Hindi, so then we would translate for them.
Even today, we are in touch with him. A few days ago,
yeah,
we called
him. He keeps calling us up. We keep calling him up. And we want to
9 years later.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Vijayashanti, we are expecting a film for you, from you very soon.
Sir, I just
Amudan.
Yes,
Amudan, I want to ask, share something.
Sure. I'll just get back to you. Oh, just wait for a minute. Let me ask Roshini.
Thank you.
I make that.
Thank you for this lovely film. It was like many others felt extremely poetic, and the style of the filmmaking, the style of the photography really gelled with the topic. I have a question. Why is it that most films come in trilogies rather than any other number? Perhaps you can make the mold and make a, you said you had material for two more films, a pentology, the Kachi pentology maybe?
No, when we started making this film, we didn't even know that we would make a new monology to start with. We just made that film, and then it led to the second one. And then we didn't know that the third one was coming up. But then the third one was made only in 2017 because, first one in 9 and 11, that was quite quick succession. Then the 17, we were so busy with all our teaching and all our other kind of activities. So we could only make it in 17. And as I said earlier, we have so much material because it started up as a project of documenting some of these very, very rare traditions. So we have huge amount of material. So we just want to get back to it sometime. Because this was made in 2000 and the last one, the trilogy was made in 18. So hopefully,
now
with time willing, we will be doing a pentology.
Thank you.
Okay. Nice.
And now we have more time on our hands.
Yes. But we have also wanted to take a break from Kutch. It's like, if you've eaten, if you had smelled too much perfume, you smell coffee for a while, so you can go to the next perfume.
Like a palate cleanser, maybe.
So now at the moment, we're just kind of taking a break. We might get back.
Thank you. Thank you for the lovely film. And waiting for eagerly for the next two.
Thank you. Hopefully.
Okay. So Meghnath is here. Meghnath, we showed Meghnath's film, Meghnath's and Vijutopo's film three days back. And Meghnath is in, we all know, a very senior filmmaker from Ranchi and a teacher, filmmaker, activist. Meghnath, you wanted to say something?
Yes. What I wanted to say is that the previous question that someone had asked, I want to continue there, that here is Anjali and Jain Shankar. They are making film for last 20 years. And the set, on a subject, like, peace in the days of hatred. Peace in the days of hatred. We have Anand Patwardhan also doing the same type of work in a very different structure. And here I see Jaishankar and Anjali from Nata, in that Dharavi, the hatred one way and the peace. Unfortunate, both the protagonists of Nata, I think, are not with us in this world. But what?
No, Bhav is there.
Achha.
The older person is still
alive. I'm sorry. I'm very happy to know that they are.
We just spoke to him before this meeting.
Oh, please, I will be very happy. But what I want to say that how ordinary people are trying to do ordinary thing for peace. That was Nata. And why I like Nata also, as a filmmaker, you both were nothing. These are the people who are spreading hate. These are the people who are talking of peace and we are documenting it. No. You both are also there as individual and you are representing yourself with a toothbrush or with this or that and that. And some good question, some stupid question. And in the process, You are telling to tell that, no. One has, doesn't have to see it from outside. We must be part of it. That was the beauty. That was the beauty of Natha, and that it continued till the next three film what we have seen. At present, I will not be in a position to tell what was today's film, because all the three film jumbled up in my brain. You know, they are all in line. But I can again tell that, you know, you ask the audience to meditate. Like, you know, any audience who is coming, he may be in a traffic jam, this and that, and coming to the hall, or, you know, before switching on to the camera, television, he was busy with so many tension. Then you allow them, you switch on, and please take 5 minutes, meditate. There are few animals that are walking on the screen. See them for 5 minutes. Because after that, there will be very ordinary people talking very ordinary thing. But you have to understand it. So for that, you must meditate. But at this time, I can say, you know, I have vanished this time. I will request only one question. You share with us that how ordinary people, hearing to this ordinary explanation of peace, how they have innocently expressed their ordinariness of peace in the hall or wherever you are. Give us some example that of that ordinariness. That is my
thing. Thank you, Meghnath. This
Meghnath,
is a wonderful observations.
Yeah, and coming from it's a huge compliment.
Meghnath is a love personified person.
No, he's really kind of, I think, caught the essence of a lot of our work, and for that I'm very grateful for you to articulate it. I think that's something that sort of we found in our everyday life, and I think we've tried to reflect in our films that there's no one guru, there's no one teaching, but we learn so much from our everyday encounters with ordinary people. You know, the person who you know, works in my house, or you know, the panwala whom I meet every day, or where I get my shoes polished or whatever. You know, these people with whom we have everyday kind of contact are actually people whom, if we think about it, there is so much that we have actually learned from them, but which very often in our, you know, hubris, our pride of that we have knowledge, we don't acknowledge, we don't understand. And I mean, it is our belief and hope, even in these kind of terrible times, that the ordinariness of peace will prevail. Because today we see such horrendous, I mean, every day we are so disturbed by, you know, the unfolding of political and social events before us. That's somewhere I think we need to witness our hope for peace, our encounters with peace, and that in the everyday, it is peace and love and not hatred that moves most of us to do what we do, to live the lives that we live. Nobody is born into this world to live in hate. We become, some of us become, you know, like that, or at moments of our life we are like that. But I don't know, maybe it is idealistic, maybe it's whistling in the dark, but I think that's something that we deeply believe in, the love and peace that ordinary people in their ordinary, people like us, we are also ordinary people, we are not extraordinary, that we actually live by, or we would like to live by.
So, as documentary filmmakers, yourself, Ramudan, and there are many others here in this group, we've all been trying to climb the same mountain from the different points and trying to grapple with it. And I could safely say the documentary fraternity is one community that has kind of stood up time and again. I mean, I'm not saying that other art forms didn't do it, but we've had kind of faced the the power of the state very closely, you know, in terms of censorship and various other. So we kind of had, as a fraternity, the documentary community has stood up, though it's marginal in the scheme of things. Nobody knows, nobody watches. So that's something that I think is very significant. And about the ordinariness, which Anjali kind of talked about, that one has learned a lot from communities that we all work with. You know, like now yourself, Ramadan. We work with various communities and we have not gone there to kind of learn about them or kind of, you know, objectify them, but learn from them. One of my favorite stories, which I just want to recount, is this story of our encounter, which when we did this film called YCP 1997, set which we made in 1997, set in Yerevan Central Prison. And there is this Nigerian poet in the film. When we met him for the first time, the one of the pointed questions that he asks us, do you think you're free? And he answers that question with a very startling answer. He said, it's a matter of the size of the prison. We live in small prisons and you live in slightly larger prisons. So the fact that we are all unfree in some sense, and we need to kind of collectively look for answers and collectively fight unfreedoms, right? Collectively kind of work with, you know, various kind of oppressive practices that you see around is something that drives all of us, isn't it? And that experience of working with these prisoners who are so-called deviants, you know, was a very, very humbling and enriching experience for us. We really learned a lot in the process.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Meghnath, and thank you, Vinayakas, for giving us a detailed and philosophical reflection. So I'll just go to other persons. I met Killy.
Good afternoon to all. Thank you for providing this opportunity, Mr. Amudan, to meet Professor Jaishankar and Anjali. I'd watched quite a number of films of yours in the past. As I work with the U.S. Library of Congress, we are meant to review for the acquisition of the Library of Congress in Washington. So I'd watched quite a number of you, to name few, I think, a collective memory of ourselves and our bodies and 100 years abroad. It's good to meet you in person. I, in fact, made sure that I come to this meeting despite I had some irritation in my eyes and I couldn't watch the film fully. Until I watched almost 3/4 of the film I could able to watch. The first thing that struck me was the word Jat. As I live in North India, the term Jat is a different phenomenon in the cultural arena of North India. So there was a very contrasting cultural difference that I could find. Do they have an ethnological or a cultural connection between the Jats in North India and these nomadic pastoral communities? That's one thing I wanted to know. The landscape and the topography that the camera has captured is captivating. I mean, certain things actually took me to an illusion. Like I could see an image where the two trucks come in. I was keenly into the screen and then the trucks disappear. That's an illusion that has been created, and I think it reflects several things within the film. And as the Sufi tradition is more a kind of an oral tradition and has a completely a different spiritual arena, but you have also brought in the realities of the community in a very, very beautiful manner. The people who mentioned earlier also referred of the conversation that these two people are having when they are cutting the vegetables. Well, I could find a subtle sarcasm of modernity in their conversation. This person is saying that nowadays there are machines to cut the vegetables. and then very next statement is very, very, very striking one. He says, we will have machines to feed in the future. People won't use hands. So that's a very, very striking statement that he makes, which has a causal relation and a confronting relationship with the tradition and modernity. And their perception of life is completely different from what we see. And the perception what we have on them is completely a diminishing one. So it's like it's slapping straight away on the real existence of modernity. So So that there are certain statements that are really fantastic. I love the movie until I watched. The cinematography was fantastic, and it went well with the movie. I would completely watch the movie and then come to the conclusion. But thank you very much for providing this excellent film that brings in this the nomadic community into the public realm. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Very perceptive and interesting comments. In fact, that shot when he says, talks about, you know, they eat with machines, it's sort of Charlie Chaplin, modern times sort of comes to mind, you know, the kind of violence of the machine and the way in which. So, yeah, there is this constant sort of, and even towards the end, you may not have seen that bit. There's an old person who's talking about Pitaya. Then he says that young people are not interested in Pitaya any longer. They are busy with their bikes, you know, their machines. So throughout there is this kind of reflection on what do machines mean to us and, you know, how do we negotiate our relationship with machines.
And one thing that's also significant about their lives is this, you know, I talked about this insignificance of human beings. But the larger web of life, for example, the presence of animals in their lives. I mean, we just, for us, animals are something alien, but for them, you know, they have hundreds of animals of various kinds, and they know each of them. For a buffalo and another buffalo to be the same, you know, I can't even distinguish. But they know each of them. They have hundreds of goats, and they know each one of them. So it also kind of, you know, also points to the fact of, in a non-anthropocentric way of life, you know, this human, not even human being, it's a man. But it's a very patriarchal world where man occupies the center of the universe, so to speak. So here there is another way of worldview, which they have, they're the connection with the world and the animals around them is really very different. They kind of, and this whole idea of traditional modernity, which you bring up very interestingly, that's, and what is also interesting is that, for example, Haji had a long, later on conversation told me when we were doing some paper around this. He said, you know, most people come to us and ask us, what is your cropping pattern? How much do you earn? What fertilizer do you, you know, things like that. But nobody has ever asked me, and he thanked us for doing this. Nobody has ever asked me, what is my cultural practices? What is the kind of music that I love? Or what is the poetry that I read? And he said, there are only a couple of people who have done this, and I thank you for asking me and not about, you know, treating me as an economic entity, you know, for some survey which, you know, you collect information about them. So, I mean, I think that was an important experience for me, for us, in some sense. So thank you for bringing up that idea.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So let me go to other friends. We have Pratap, a cinematographer in Kerala. Pratap, what happened to your arm? Why are you still having this? Still not recovered?
It is recurring, no problem. Just use the sling. Hi all. It's a wonderful film. I think everything is fine. Camera, especially Gilly said, wonderful camera. The composition is very interesting. The sound, the treatment, the way you connect with the people and the people connect with you also very interesting. I think earlier said, I think it is very meditative one, I feel so. Very meditative documentary. And wait to watch the other films also. This is the first movie I watched your films. I watched first time. And waiting for the other movies also. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
So hopefully we'll have other films also. Can I go to Madhava Murthy?
Yeah, so hi everyone. So by the way, we are all students of our professors here. So for me, just coming here and being part and hearing the whole discussion itself is kind of overwhelming. And for me, watching the movie, there's so many things running in my head. And it was more of a meditative experience for sure. Most of them have covered so many aspects and so much of insights have been spoken about, but especially those shots of like mirroring and, you know, the kind of gives it reflection and mirages. So those kind of, like, I was completely dissolved into the whole, the whole process of watching the film. So I would like to thank for the opportunity to even come and attend here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Can I invite Sujata? Sujata? Okay.
Yeah, I'm having a little bit of network issue.
Yeah, we can hear you.
We
can hear you well.
I just wanted to ask, sir and madam, how did this film change you as filmmaker or as human being?
That's an interesting question and probably very difficult to articulate because we are not always even aware of how our encounters with our subjects and our engagement with a particular theme changes us, but certainly does change us. I think the kind of, not just this film, but the entire series of films in Kutch, you know, sort of made us so acutely aware of the wellsprings of compassion and love that exist in, you know, these spaces and how precious these spaces are and how much under threat they are today. Because even in the, you know, from, as I said, from 2008 till today, over a decade that we've been engaging with people there, you see the kind of subtle changes that are taking place, you know, particularly with the, you know, rise of Hindutva and also the rise of a more, you know, hardened version of Islam. And it's certainly, you know, sort of affecting the fabric of everyday life in various ways, the industrialization that is coming in. So, I mean, to us, you know, sort of engaging with these spaces, with these people has been very, very precious and has also got us to question many of the ways we see the world, the way we look at time, you know. As somebody said, you know, you as when we come from the city, we are used to everything working very quickly. We are used to, you know, going from here to there, to this location and that location. But when you go to Kutch, you've got to, you know, forget about that to some extent. You just have to take a deep breath and relax and, you know, let things unfold, very often not within your control, but you have a belief or a faith or a hope that something is going to come out of it anyway. So I don't know, it's an experience of sort of encountering and working with uncertainties, which is perhaps, as Jayashankar said earlier, what life is all about. We are very uncomfortable with the idea of certainty, of uncertainty. We want everything to be, we have our plans for our work and, you know, our lives and our children's lives and, you know, whatever. But the idea that at the end of the day, you know, why can't we be open to multiplicities? Why can't we be open to uncertainty? Why can't we be open to more compassionate ways of, more tolerant ways of engaging with the people around us and our reality? I think that's certainly something that our many years in Kutch have helped us to, you know, realize.
And the equanimity, you know, they are very poor in material terms, but very rich in terms of what they can offer, what they can offer the world, so to speak. And, you know, their life is always on an edge. In fact, that's one reason why I always, I mean, bend against established principles of composition, you know, in camera. I have put them, I mean, kind of placed them in such a way that they are actually on the edge of that frame, you know, just at the bottom. So they always, but the equanimity with which they look at life, you know, in spite of very, very difficult, there's either drought either floods, because the water, when it rains, the water doesn't just drain. So that's how runs are made. I mean, the run of Kutch is made because the water just stays there and brings up salinity. So it's during whenever rainy season, very, very few days it rains, but it's completely flooded. Like it becomes like an ocean, or you know, in the summer it's so hot. And but in spite of which, they have some kind of equanimity. And in fact, go to some of the villages. I mean, the earlier film, he would tell us, "I can't offer you water, but I can give you milk because they have so many animals." You know, so you know the kind of equanimity with which they deal with is something that is very, very commendable. In addition to what Anthony just spoke about.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Now I invite, we have Ramdas Kadavalur, filmmaker from Kerala. Ramdas has recently made a called Mannu, interesting film. So we also screened the film as part of our online film screening, which are well received, and we are happy to have Ramdas here. Ramdas, go ahead.
Yeah, comrade, I'm connecting from my village, so there is a network issue. There is nothing to say much about the film because they are the filmmakers, much experience, and already made some 30 more films. So as a child, as a student, as a person who recently into filmmaking, for me, it is a very learning experience. So that is what I would say. There are many, many things has been discussed already here. So almost everything has been covered. One simple question, what I may ask to them is how they fix the style, how you are fixing the style of the film, and the second question maybe how you are choosing a subject. So that may be the two things I just wanted to ask. Otherwise, it's a wonderful film, and it was, as Pradab said, Pradab was my cinematographer in my film. So as he said, it's a meditating experience even, and it's an opportunity to understand the community as well. So thank you for bringing this film, and thank you for making this film even. So this is what, and for me, it's a learning experience. So this is the two things I just wanted to ask to Anjali Madam and Jayashankar sir.
Thank you. That's so wonderful to hear this.
Yeah, you should watch Mr. Jayashankar and Ms. Dr. Anjali. You should watch his films. It's been a wonderful film. Mm-hmm. Mannu.
I'll share the link. I'll mail to you.
So that is the whole idea of this screening, connecting people, connecting filmmakers, inspiring new people to make films. Like Vijay Shanti, we wanted to make films. Okay. So can I invite Debaranjan, filmmaker from Odisha?
Or should we address Ramdas'
question? Ramdas, okay. Okay,
yeah.
Sorry, I missed
time. We do not have a fixed style. These three films, I mean, they are they're slightly different from each other. I mean, this trilogy itself, but generally, kind of, I mean, about how we kind of visualize it. One is the idea of grief or dukkham, or the other idea of insignificant, or the idea of lack of control. These are some of the ways in which that film was. If I may call it style, was kind of, you know, identified. The way we took the shot, trying to have a very wide shot and not very, shuttling between very wide shots to very macro kind of shots. So they're kind of looking at this whole world. That's all that is there. But in what we have, attempting is a very important word, is to kind of identify a particular way of storytelling depending on that particular theme we are working on. So if you were to be 30-35 odd films, and you know, we think that they are, each one of them are different, but there are the set of concerns that we bring to bear, which we talked about, how talking about not being exploitative, not being predatory of the communities that we work, not being being more compassionate, and the willingness to learn from them rather than, you know, these are some of the concerns that kind of stayed with us for right from the beginning of our filmmaking learning process. So I didn't kind of stay, but I don't think there's any particular, these three films have a different way in which we edited them, different way in which they were timed. You know, they were, I mean, I mean, one of our favorite filmmakers is Manikol. So, you know, although we do not actually make films like him, but we kind of very inspired by some of his ideas that he kind of talks about as a film as a temporal medium. Film is an animation and stuff like that, which we kind of try doing it here to some extent. But it's not, of course, not like his style at all. But I mean, we were in a world with various formats and in our world.
Yeah, as regards the choice of the theme, how do we decide that we want to make a film on something? Well, actually, in our heads, we carry so many, many, many different films. We read something, we, you know, and only a fraction of those films we end up making. Sometimes it is, you know, almost like a matter of chance, a lot of the time, in fact. Like we wanted to do a film with prisoners who wrote poetry, and we carry that idea for several years until we met a former student who was working in the prison department. That's how that film happened. Our work in Cut started just from, you know, we happened to meet a friend who was working there, and we saw those images. And also, a lot of the times there are certain concerns, and then you are in a situation where you sort of you see a possibility, and then out of those possibilities, some of them work out, some of them don't. So it's not. I mean, of course, there are bread and butter films that we've made, which have been commissioned work for other people. But I'm talking about the films that we feel are our own, that, you know, we've sort of made, you know, because we love to do it.
So thank you.
So can I invite Devaranjan, filmmaker from Odisha?
Yes. Hello.
Yes, sir. We can hear you. Yes, go ahead.
That's.
We can also see you. Your beautiful smile. Yeah.
Thank you, Amundan. Actually, this film, I saw it first time in Thrissur Film Festival some years back. And within me, I was searching it to see it again. It was large scale, beautiful. But and my perception regarding this quite changed after watching your film during that period, to nomadic tribes and to those are the tribes. We generally, the journalist ask them from the economic point of view, how you are staying, what is your condition, but cultural aspect was mostly ignored. So, and in that way, actually, when I saw it that time, I realized that certain cultural thing is there, which we have not explored and you have it. And in between, actually, I was watching Indus Blue. You might have seen it about the Sufi tradition in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. And that is under coming pressure also due to Islamic State. Mm-hmm. And when I watch your film again in these days, this festival, this also coming key under pressure of extinction is coming to. So either Islamic State or in India's capitalist state or modernity. Do you not realize that both of these things, and in both way, the Sufi traditions, instruments, musics are going away from our memories and going at the verge of extinction. Yes. So one thing is that I'm realizing it. And second thing is, I was reading your book. We, as a documentary filmmaker, we are very familiar to your work. So the Fly in the Curry, you have mentioned about independent filmmaking, independent. What is its future? Also, I can ask to Amundan also, what is its future? Because nowadays, Prasar Bharati and this PSBT and this Government of India's position is changing. So how you see but independently making on your thought and bringing it into the visual form. So how you see its future, this work? Because I am not finding much hope in this situation, because the films are, I had seen your YCP 1979. It's a nice movie, actually. I had not thought of the prisoners, so beautiful written the poems and and you have, you can compile it, you can bring it in a film. So these are the very nice ideas you have brought, mainly cultural thing, which we had ignored or we had not thought of it. So to look, to go with this thought, how you see it, its future, or in general also documentary film future, how you see it, and how you see it, the documentary film nowadays. Thank you. And your film I have seen, so it's already I said ki, that time also changed my perception towards the this right. And thank you for that. Thank you, Jed.
Thank you. Yeah, the question you raise about the future of independent documentary is a very you know, large question, and probably something we cannot you know, really entirely discuss here. But a couple of points that I'd like to make is first, I think in some sense the access to the digital and to the internet has helped documentary film in some ways, independent documentary, because today you know, people can sort of get access to the means of production and make something and sort of make it available, which was not possible in the past when people worked with celluloid, which was a very expensive business, or even later when the kind of analog professional you know, video equipment. So at one level it appears to be that you know, there are more spaces for saying what one wants to say. At another level, the entire sort of institutional structures for supporting this work are, as you have rightly pointed out, completely under threat. And you know, particularly with the right-wing government you know, in place, they will be certainly further you know, kind of attacked. And we see it happening all around us, both attacks on the filmmakers themselves, attacks on the you know, ability for funding this kind of work, and you know, attacks on even screening of alternative work.
Yeah. It's good to talk about a future, but you know, for example, you know, look at what Amudan has been doing all these years, you know, organizing film festivals. Even now, he's just telling us that a couple of hundred people watched the film in 24 hours, which I think are great for a filmmaker. I can't you know, really hope to reach so many audiences. But at the same time, you know, if I were to depend on my, I mean, to kind of make a living out of this, it is very difficult. You know, I mean, for example, we need to have more institutional support. For example, in other countries where their television shows a lot of documentaries, and there is support for documentary work, which is, they think is a very significant contribution to society. But here, documentary film, each documentary film is a struggle. Each one of us who made a film knows how difficult it is to sustain ourselves. We've kind of had institutional support, fortunately, without much you know, thought control. So therefore, we could make some of these films with very low budgets, but at the same time, possible. But it's on. And if you were to really look at in the last few years, even the little funding that was available, like PSPT or, you know, various other institutions that were funding, Film Division was funding as well, it's completely dried up. There is no way that you can make a documentary unless it's a really, it's almost like a harakiri project, you know, to kind of, because it's, how do you, you can make a film, probably distribute it, because there are festivals like, or, you know, channels like filmmakers and people who have, you know,
on Netflix,
no. Netflix and all that possible. But the question here is that of how do you recover the kind of, you know, money you spend to make a film, even to kind of, you know, take, make your next film. I mean, it's not possible for us to kind of put our own money and make this film and nobody watches. I mean, there is no way of, there are thousands of films being made, but the problem is how do you reach an audience? And even if you reach an audience, how do you then now at least recover some of the money that you spent? I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, we make spectacular amounts of money, at least to make the next project, you know, next film. So these are things that we need to kind of think about. There have been various attempts to kind of distribute work. For example, Magic Lantern distributed with DVDs. You know, they tried a lot to kind of distribute. is still there, but you know, now people don't buy DVDs, or you know, the technology is gone and controlled by the state. I mean, unless television, state television has to show documentaries, then there is, that's the only way that documentaries can move forward. But where does any television channel, because when there was only one Doordarshan, I mean, to tell you frankly, we could show films on Doordarshan. They have shown our work, and I'm sure many of us have shared our work on Doordarshan. And we thought when the opening up of this, you know, satellite channels and hundreds and channels coming up, the opportunities will go up. But actually, it has become less and less and less. Now there is nobody, because they are all invariably political. They also deal with subjects which are not comfortable with, you know, the state. Come down heavily on us. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's
of course.
And, you know, if you were to also the other, some of the filmmakers have successfully negotiated this kind of dealing with the, you know, transnational channels or, you know, foreign channels. But you know, if you're making a film for those kind of channels, you have to make it differently, isn't it? I have to tell even an audience where Mumbai is, or where even India is for that matter. So it's kind of a difficult, I mean, it's a different kind of film that you make for that kind
of film. Even the kinds of stories that sell, that travel internationally, may not always be the kinds of stories we want to make. You know, so willy-nilly, I mean, today the only successful documentary is successful in terms of, I mean, being able to earn a living from documentary filmmaking are those who are pitching to international channels, and somewhere at the end of the day, it begins to shape the language of the film you make, the kinds of concerns that are seen as interesting to international audiences. And we might want to, the kind of film Abudhan wants to make, or you want to make, or I want to make, may not have that kind of you know, interest. Even the style of filmmaking, the pacing of a film, I mean, television audiences we know have you know, woefully short, or even audiences on OTT platforms, short attention spans. I mean, how do you you know, show a film like this on a television channel? People will probably switch to the next channel. So I mean, there are a whole lot of issues here, and given the kind of state, I don't think we can, in the near future, expect any kind of support from the state. On the contrary, we can expect all kinds of.
And as people who have engaged, as rightly pointed out, people who have engaged with the documentary form and its history, I mean, I don't think any other country has that kind of diversity. Yeah. In terms of documentary form in India, you know, there's so many different kinds and different ways in which people are engaging. I mean, where, of course, when, as Anjali said, when television takes over, they all want us to make the same kind of documentaries. But here, in terms of languages, in terms of
culture,
the form, the strategy, you know, there's so much diversity. That's a strength, and there's also the weakness of our, you know. Because there's so many different languages, subtitling and then reaching to other audiences. Culturally, even we do not know each other's worlds so well. We might know better about Europe or America than, you know, the neighboring state or the district, so to speak. So these are some of the challenges that we do. But as teachers, we have been insisting in our curriculum that documentary is a very important resource. You know? Because documentary kind of also, as a form, demands a whole lot of skills, like, you know, research, working with communities, being aware of the political kind of, you know, connotations of your work, the idea of representation, its politics. These are all things that you need to be aware of. So, I mean, as our own MA program, we kind of insist on students engaging with documentary because it does open up their horizons.
And you are teaching in peace also. So, has it any created any impact, Sohodan film, on the students to cover the tribes in Maharashtra? Because 2-3 communities, Sifod communities are there, they have the rich culture also. I had small time to interact with them when I was in Pune for some days. So, I was thinking the students can make film, and your film could have created certain impacts and then to follow their life, and has it created or no?
Impact, I would say, but we have enjoyed. I mean, we must have worked over 30 years. About our count is about 15,000 students in our life, you know, you engage with it. It's a huge number. So, what is for us is important that we kind of learned a lot from young people. So it rubs on, you know, in spite of our gray hair somewhere, you know, engagement with the young people teaches you a lot. They know they have much more energy and, you know, utopian investment. I mean, they are more idealistic. I don't think, but I mean, if from personal experience, you know, working in this, I think there are hundreds of documentaries that the students have made. Some of them have brilliant work. May not be in terms of production values and large budgets, but they kind of been able to make very, very interesting work. I mean, in fact, we have a YouTube channel. There are, you know, hundreds of films that are being made. And for us, working with students have been an interesting experience. I don't think we had much impact on them, but they certainly have an impact on us.
Siksha has given a comment. Can you read, Anjali? Can you see Siksha's comment?
No, it must
I
be.
I liked how the women of the tribes, their tribes learned to read and write. Also the musing by Halima that she likes to hear Surando, all of them.
Mm-hmm.
As it is their heritage. Because Siksha has given a comment. She can't, she says she won't be able to speak. So I asked her to text them.
Okay.
Yeah, she must have marked up a comment to you. Or not.
She must have, it's not marked to the
Okay.
It must be private.
Okay. So we have two more people. We have Chitra and we have Yuvraj Bajaj. Yuvraj, can we go to you? Can we start? Do you have any comment question?
Yeah, no, I don't have a question and I frankly don't even have a comment. I just wanted to attend this session and I am just subscribed to your WhatsApp updates, and as soon as I read that the people who made this film, Dr. Shankar and Jay Shankar and Montero ma'am, they were from Cultural Studies Department. So I am a student actually from Whistling Woods, and Cultural Studies is one of our subjects there, and it's really one of my favorite subjects. So as soon as I read that you are also from Cultural Studies Department at TIS, I was very excited to just hear you. And I'll certainly watch your film. I was checking YouTube, and in YouTube also PSBT has your film. Mm-hmm. And I'll watch the film and I'll contact you separately. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Chitra, do you have a question, comment?
Yes, sir. No question, but it's just that I happened to meet ma'am and sir during the film appreciation course in 2011. So there was an interaction arranged. They did screen, she writes. So I got that opportunity and I have interacted with two students of theirs.
Can you introduce yourself? Where are you from and like where, which college?
Yeah, I'm teaching in Loyola, Chennai. So I teach in the Department of Digital Journalism. So we have a subject called documentary theory. So that is how, and I was introduced to documentary film through Amudan sir, because he taught me when I did study in Holy Cross College, Trichy. So then I have happened to meet your students, one Bhavadarni and one more Joseph Aloysius. So they have spoken much about you. So then it was like, I studied in school somewhere in non-detail that when women are concerned, the unexpected always happens. So it was like running in my mind, I should not be missing this, you know, from the beginning. But I was there in front of my laptop doing something, and all of a sudden at 12, it, you know, it clicked that, you know, oh, I was not part of this interaction from the beginning. So I have screened this documentary to my students for the first few batches, like UG batch. So like it was the initial part of like different genres, how they are getting exposed to, what all forms are there. So many would be like, it's very slow paced one, Sohidan. And later they would comment that it's very interesting. It gives us a very different perspective. It's a visual treat as well as it is very good to, you know, hear something musically. So that way, like, the students have always appreciated. And it's like due to the data conception part, like many students couldn't join today. But I hope that I would just get in touch with Amudin sir and get your mail ID so that we could arrange one session with these students exclusively to the department because they have this course. So what else or what better than interacting with the filmmakers? So that gives you a different perspective. So I believe in that. So thanks a lot, ma'am. And yes, best wishes.
And this slowness, I mean, in fact, as a joke, one of, a couple of years ago, our students made a film called Slow Hedan, Slow Hodan.
It was a spoof of, it was a film that they made for an alumni meet. And they call it Slow Hedan, Slow Hodan. It's quite hilarious.
Very funny.
Okay. So nice. I think we have covered everybody, and after hearing the discussion, if anybody wants to give a comment or question, they can go ahead. Quick, not they can't take more than a minute because already 12:55.
Hi, I'm Manoj here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, hi. I don't have any specific questions, but thanks a lot, Jayashankar sir and Anjali madam, to bring. It's a wonderful film. Especially the content wise, everyone has already covered, but the technical wise also, I really liked it, especially the initial scene itself and editing and cinematography, script, everything was very, very high, very excellent actually. So I really liked it. And thanks a lot, Amudin also, and the Marvakam, because Jayashankar was mentioning about the position of the documentary society. So as a personal way, I was very not much interested in documentary realities, but the Marvakkam has triggered me, encouraged me actually to see a lot of documentaries. Nowadays, a lot of time I actually spending to watch a lot of documentaries. So I really realized the importance of the documentary. So thanks, Amudin and Marvakkam. Encourage me in this to watch a lot of good documentaries. Thanks a lot, Jayashankar sir and Anjali ma'am, for the all the best. Thanks, Amit.
Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Final comments? Okay. So the if the filmmakers have any comments, final comments, we can wind up.
Really like to thank Amudin and all of you. It has been a really interesting discussion, and I think many different aspects of the film which perhaps for us even were new that people saw and picked up was something. I think it was a wonderful discussion and we really enjoyed it, and I hope you all have also enjoyed it, and really, really very
yeah grateful. It was wonderful, Amudin. Thank you for this, and of course the continued work that you do, which is very, very inspiring. But for me, this was a very interesting discussion, such a long discussion. Normally, when you have a screening, there are a few questions, but these, all the comments that were made so insightful, and it was a lot to think about. And of course, very, very insightful comments. And it's such a long discussion, and it's been a learning experience for us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And so the film will be all on till tomorrow evening 6:00. So please inform your friends if you have others also who have not watched the film. And we will also be having a film every weekend. So be in touch. We'll keep you posted. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Anjali. Thank you, Dr. Jayashankar, for sharing your film. We have recorded this interaction also, so we will be uploading it in my YouTube channel. So those who want to watch, get back to the revisit discussion, they can always do. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you. Have a safe Sunday and have a nice Sunday.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Bye bye.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.